Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. This is Gunjan, and a very warm welcome to all of you to Rethink the Future webinar series. Through this session, we aim to discuss and deliberate over various moving parts and challenges of implementing a resilient cloud-based digital infrastructure that propels our organization into an exciting, highly competitive future business landscape. Today's session is attended by senior IT leaders like yourselves from across the country, and we are actively working on emerging digital technologies in their organization. Please join me in welcoming our session chair and moderator for the session, Mr. Rajesh Nair, Associate Partner Markets, Ernst & Young. Mr. Nair currently heads the Kochi office of Ernst & Young and leads all service lines of Ernst & Young in Kerala. He additionally focuses on digital transformation projects and leads business for financial service sectoral practice in South India. We welcome you, Mr. Nair.
Thanks, Gunjan.
Now, I'd also like to introduce our power-packed panel for the evening, and we'll begin with Dr. Puneet Kaur Kohli, who's the Chief Technology Officer, Manappuram Finance Limited. Dr. Kohli is an IT leader with track record of 23-year-plus experience, having extensive knowledge on developing, implementing strategic plans, and addressing the company needs and promoting growth. We welcome you, Dr. Kohli. The next panelist today is Mr. A. Balakrishnan, who is the Executive Director, Geojit Financial Services. Mr. Balakrishnan has been associated for more than 22 years with Geojit in various capacities such as Chief Technology Officer and now Executive Director heading Operation IT. Welcome, Mr. Balakrishnan. The next panelist for the evening is Dr. Nagarajan Ravindran, who is the Chief Information Officer for Shakti Finance Limited. Dr. Ravindran has over 39 years of experience in information technology and related management disciples. Welcome, Dr. Ravindran.
Thank you.
Our next panelist today is Mr. Suresh Shanmugam, who's a renowned researcher and technology lead architect in computer science, as well as Vice Chairman, Computer Society of India, Mumbai Chapter. Welcome, Mr. Shanmugam. Next panelist for today is Mr. Amit Jalkar, who's the Chief Digital Officer, NKGSB Co-op Bank. Mr. Jalkar is a seasoned IT professional with a passion to create business opportunities crafted from connected world. He has demonstrated leadership in cloud computing, mobility, virtualization, IT infrastructure, BYOD, etc. We welcome you, Mr. Jalkar. The next panelist is Mr. Shekhar Rao, who's the Chief Information Officer, SavvyApp. Mr. Rao has over 26 years of banking and FMCG industry experience with proven skills in business strategy and operations. Welcome, Mr. Rao.
Hi.
Last but not the least, we have Mr. Mohit Arora, who is the Senior Director, Commercial and Government Sales, VMware India. Mr. Arora has been associated with the Indian IT industry for more than two decades. At VMware, he leads the commercial and government vertical, essentially responsible at VMware India business from customers in multiple industry segments and PSUs across the country. So once again, a very, very warm welcome and thank you very much for joining the panel today. And now I request our moderator, Mr. Nair, to take over and proceed with the panel. Thank you very much.
Thanks, Gunjan. Welcome to all the panelists and welcome to all the audience who've joined in from various parts of India. What we will do in the next one and a half hours is we will hear all these experts in terms of their opinions of where they see technology moving their respective companies, where they see technology moving their sector. Some of them are from the NBFC industry. We would also want to hear how is NBFC industry leveraging technology and looking at various aspects of business with technology to reach out to customers to deliver better products, etc. So what we will do is we'll do an initial round where each of us will speak for 7 to 8 minutes, and then I'll quickly sort of sum up, and then we again do a quick 1 or 2 minutes on, you know, what is their big idea, what are they seeing, and you know, what is one thing that they're seeing in technology around them in their industry, or it could be outside as well, and then we will open it up for questions. For those of you who are giving questions, in case you want your questions answered and in case we are not able to pick it up, do post your email IDs along with your questions so that we can answer to some of those questions which we are not able to pick up. Just my two bits before we start. I think we have seen a lot of interesting changes in business over the last two decades, and we are seeing more changes in the last 3 years than probably what we saw in the last 30 years. And one of those things is technology. While some fundamentals of business have not changed, we are still worried about what the customer wants. We are still worried about how to know what she wants and what is the best things that we should deliver for her. We also constantly seek to improve our customer understanding. So that never changes. Our constant quest to improve our products and services never changes. We want to deliver the best products. We want to deliver the best services at the optimal costs, etc. So the second part of that fundamental list doesn't change. The third part, which is sales and distribution, how do we reach our customers, what channels to use, etc., it doesn't change again. But if you look at all these three, customer understanding, product knowledge, sales and distribution, one common thread across it, which sort of binds it and which is increasingly binding it in very interesting ways, is technology. And all these ladies and the lady and the gentleman in this panel, all of them have very insightful experience, as you've heard in the introductions, many years of having worked before, before the incidence of technology, and they've really seen the scale of what technology has brought. So I'll pass it now on to the speakers to hear what they have individually experienced, their opinions about the industry. Dr. Puneet, I'm passing it on to you.
First of all, let me thank you and the panels to give us an opportunity to be on this podium and sharing my thoughts with all my fellow panelists as well. So good afternoon to you all. So see, this COVID situation and the all the pandemics that are happening is basically, it has changed the entire mode of IT. What we really basically, what we had envisaged as a part of our budgeting exercise or, next 2 or 2-3 years landscape is like in terms of the total digitalization and all. I think so that was defined almost 2 to 3 years back. But to encourage and to, basically encash the opportunities was, I think so pandemic was the ideal situation where these digitizations and all that all the companies are putting focus on has really, reaped its benefits. Working from home was a new normal, but with context to Indian markets, I said that work from home has got no limitation. At least, work from home, that like 8 hours kind of a thing, we have a good work-life balance when we work from home. Actually, it was a convenience being extended to the employees, who might have some work. Maybe they are going somewhere or something, some other preoccupancies which enables them to work from home facilities. But in our scenario, work from home was never as a part of our IT mandate. So first of all this, as a representation of an NBFC, there was a big mandate from RBI in terms of like what are the BCP practices that, as a CIO, you are taking in place. That was not only in terms of uptime of IT available, applications to give an uptime. It is also ensuring that like the entire risk that are associated with all business continuity management systems are in place. So which was already there for IT, BCP was there. So when we talk about disasters, all these things have been taken care of. Whether it is with respect to the all that RBI guidelines or a mandate, which is like, a mandate which talks about NBFCs to factor, which came in June 2017. And by 2018, June 1, all the NBC have to declare themselves that we have put that framework in place. And, a quarter on quarter compliance certificate is being submitted to RBI for that we are compliant. We have done all the necessary that has been talked about. So doing that perspective, I think so BCP has made a very, very big role. In fact, started only work from home facility. We did not even have a work from home policy in place, though we were giving all the convenience to our key critical process owners, which is across all departments, mapping with the laptops that any kind of convenience they can work from, even post office hours when they are there. So it worked like a thing where there was no uniform laptop policy for everybody. So the pandemic situation is where, you give a remote desktop, you give the Cisco VPN, AnyConnect clients, and, basically ensure that the connectivity is uptime and, people are able to access through their corporate, apps which is being given as a part of, earlier as a restriction, now a blanket approval being given so that, to deviate certain processes and, everybody is able to work in terms of disbursement, in terms of collection, in terms of so many things. Apart from us, many more collection apps were introduced, and the things which were taking 2 to 2 weeks to complete in our in-house development team, we in 2 to 2 working days we completed that. And the quality assurance and information technology, or you can say information security team, was like very much round the clock working in terms of not to compromise on the code, the quality assurance in place, or you can say the tools like VAPTs, because the information security practice was also there. Unless we were saying that we are not getting probably banked by anything, hacking is not there in place. So all these things really gave an eye-opener for a CIO that you are not a CIO anymore. You are responsible to make an uptime for your business. And the more collections are there, the more the business generates value, the more you have the convenience to your internal and external customers is, making you productive. And apart from that, definitely external customer engagements, how to reach out to them, maybe in the form of emails, in the form of SMS, bots, all these technologies, emerging technologies has played a very big role in terms of, whether it is RP, robotics process is taking place, or it is through email communications are there, or if social media planning is in place, or some algorithms which are put across in your rule engines, talking about analytics or artificial intelligence, this is the time when, these are new age technologies really played a very big role in reaping the benefits. That is what we got as a productivity and performance out of IT and other business critical functions.
Thanks a lot, Muni. ABK sir.
Good afternoon. Thanks for inviting for this panel discussion. Regarding this particular technology journey, actually during the course of time, we started as a very small organization. When I joined, my purpose was joining in this company was setting up an IT infrastructure for expansion, controls and ease of doing our transactions monitoring. And this is a very risky business, so we are handling risky assets and investments of the clients, so we have to have a proper systems in place, otherwise it would be difficult to expand and enroll customers. So with that was that objective, we created data center. Then subsequently, we have a disaster recovery management center in another state, all those things we created. But what the experience is very interesting. When we have a data center and the disaster recovery management center in another city, both the cities were in a hotspot area. So we couldn't actually send people over there. So remote management of infrastructure. Now it is we never thought of such a kind of a remote management. Of course, we had certain kind of a very small set of people used to work from home. We never had a culture of working from a barring few senior people and also some firewall or some because in the night if something to be done, such people only could work from home. But otherwise, we used to work from office only. There was a couple of things I just want to update you. We have actually regulated by SEBI. There are stringent regulation on offices. These offices are actually including the address, the PIN code, from where you are operating, trading terminals, all are to be uploaded and approved by the regulator. Now, when the lockdown started, there was a small relaxation. Okay, you can also operate from home. So we migrated most of the around 900 terminals. We have around 2,500 terminals, 900 terminals we actually moved to home. And another thing is, since we have online transaction capability during the day, and market was actually extremely volatile during this period. I know that all of you are aware about this volatility and the issues related to market. So those things actually created a resilience in business. Barring this customer interaction face to face, which is actually our strength, Second point is actually there are certain things which actually we learned. For example, we used to take a lot of signature from the clients as well as internal. These signature, of course, certain areas we used to, we implement a digital signature, but by and large, a lot of documents are still on vetting the signature. So that actually created a problem during this time. So we signed up with, for example, NSDL, e-governance and e-mudra, etc. We started implementing e-signature and collect. Of course, there are again some customers have problems, but still we are managing with those. So, but what we learned from this COVID-19, the methodology we adopted for the last 3 decades is now challenged and questioned. And thanks to the technology, we started new normal with a certain kind of a limitation, but it is doable and it is improving day by day. There was a point on the technology roadmap. Now I am actually even our team is actually rethinking, why should we have such a policy? Can we have everything so that we will have some kind of a scalable? Of course, there are challenges because cloud, regulatory challenges, data challenges.
Because and a quick time check, sir.
Yeah. Right. Yeah. It is over. It is one. So 2 points. So that is how actually the technology journey. That is all we'll discuss later. Okay. Thank you.
Sure. Thanks. Dr. Ravindran.
In fact, I thought of giving my views in 2 dimensions. One is taking current COVID-19 part, and second, of course, the digital transformation. See, COVID-19, it rather created a VUCA sort of situation among us. But as far as IT is concerned, I think it's we had a lot of eye openers. I think Dr. Puneet mentioned about RBI regulations, BCP policies, controls, etc. We also, as a non-banking finance company, we established that, and we were monitoring, and we are monitoring it very regularly. But work from home concept, I think luckily it is not very new to us, because we were practicing it earlier also. All branch managers, all key executives were given that access, I think some 4-5 years back. So they were enjoying it. So we extended that facility to another 30 members, with hired laptops or new laptops. And our configuration was already established. We ensured the security, etc. And then we provided to them. So as far as the COVID-19 situation is concerned, in fact, IT people, we are in the limelight, and a lot of expectations also set now. So in my views, digital transformation, one of the core delivery should be enhancing the customer experience. Customer is an important stakeholder. And in fact, we are a deposit taking non-banking finance company. And one set of high purchase customers, main business customers, they're truck operators. Their level of technology adoption or education and all, it is relatively less actually. In fact, due to COVID, we also learned a lesson about that. I'll cover up that soon. I think we are taking a lot of initiatives under digital transformation to make it automated for taking care of this regulatory bodies. In fact, submitting RBI report, let us make it to the very automated way. And another thing is one of the important business stakeholders, I think hackers security part. Though it is a part of our life in handling security control, but for an NBFC, for anything that's become a perennial activity. So though we have RBI regulated controls in place, I think we have a separate team working on to see proactively what best can be done in that. In fact, we were thinking about using digital marketing for the past 2-3 years, but now we jumped into, thanks to COVID-19 actually, and we got a great benefit out of it. So now we are thinking of percolating this digital marketing to all other areas of our business. we already started working on it. And in fact, I was mentioning earlier, no, we were thinking, you know, customers may not be very familiar with some payment facilities like Google Pay and all, but they're very familiar. We're very surprised to know that. So now we are changing our strategy, you know, to communicate them through WhatsApp. In fact, we already done in the COVID period about, you know, the moratorium part and some other schemes, etc. to the customers, the response was good. And social, I covered mobility. It is a need of the thing for any company. We already have mobile app facilities reaching the customers. And we also recently implemented a reputed CRM, Salesforce. And you know, there the customer reaching and ultimately, you know, reducing the turnaround time from a customer approached us till, you know, the check is cut for the high purchase finance. We are seeing good improvement in that. And analytics part, I think we are moving to a different area, but the expectations of the management also is very high. It is not a typical MIS or EAS nowadays. It's all, no, they are expecting no prediction-based analytics. Management is asking, no, our 12-month EMI or 24-month EMI is there. Now he is in the middle of the thing. Whether the customer will pay regularly or not in the coming months, no, they are expecting the predictions. That is the need now. So we are started using, you know, AI and, you know, based predictions using proper tools. The same case, an existing customer is coming for another loan, where they are expecting some weightage, whether, you know, like CIBIL score, they are expecting, you know, okay, out of 100, how much mark he will score. They are expecting, you know, analytics based thing, and they want to, you know, take that as a major weightage for, you know, sanctioning another loan. And cloud is very standard. I think we already using it. So in sum up, like, you know, digital transformation, like I already mentioned, no, it is needed for all the companies, like we are talking about Industry 4.0, etc. But for NBFC, it is highly imperative and it's a must to adopt, you know, possible solutions and technologies. The role of CEO is very, very critical in that, actually. That's it, Rajesh.
Thanks a lot, sir. Suresh?
Since majority people have spoken on the NBFC part, since I don't want to repeat the same on those areas, at least everyone trying to focus on three elements, which is internal customers, again, internal, external customers, and the third one is the dealers, brokers, agents. These are the three entities revolve across and we are trying to fix it. When it comes to internal users, it's more of time and tide to let that humanity digital transformation do its own compute job, which in good olden days, maximum times the corporate end users try to comply and try to ensure like it's more of a discomfort powered pain point from the technology. Now, due to the quarantine, the entire shift from end users focus feel to listen and understand IT is must and IT is more required, and both individual and corporate to survive this medical crisis. So the expectations from individual, especially from the accounts and back office, other areas where they were slightly resistant or not using the technology, now they are forced to use it or they are trying to utilize as much as, so that it builds more the expectations from technology. And now it seems business and compliance has its expectation. Now IT chooses the secured ways and trying to drive it and compute it. When it comes to dealers, brokers, agents, entire world was forcing to do manually because the rural and the infrastructure, and they try to keep the control. Now the global markets and the local environments going more and more digital, even government related the recovery schemes and the currently whatever it was informed to the customers, we try to operate through dealers. The committed products which we receive from the common normal man, which is digitally equipped and communicate to collaborate, which was also part of the technology. Now they are trying to use as much as more towards mobile. Recently, whatever that apps which was given to dealers, in a short span, they are able to convert more than 6 to 7 lakh customers. They are able to communicate and they are able to use the same multilingual system which was available for more than 6-7 years. So the compulsion had the chance to change. The choice of digital technology was given, but now it is optimized. They are trying to feel that expectations. At least they are able to listen, understand, align to IT and the third party, especially the brokers and agents, especially in terms of fixed deposits and SME kind of thing. They try to use to resistant where the commissions and brokerage is focused more on doing some maximum things or delaying things. Now those things have changed. The end customer fundamentally related to the basics, almost cleared and clarified as much as they want to do it faster and they want to get the best out of it. And especially when it comes to lockdown, it puts us more best ways to go from IT stitches, the business perfect combination. When you say the rural, especially, it depends more on the infrastructure and trying to enable, every small thing gets transformed to humanity where we have to wait for some time and trying to create the mindsets of maximum corporate community which is trying to deliver through technology. Earlier scenario, we used to wait and pay even commissions for executing technology. Today, without even commissions, we are able to get more. And the current scenario has a choice to change and challenge. That has mentioned the intermediate system, which is the fact where the business base has gone high. The real actually concerns are the infrastructure, which was not matured or which are not aligning the volumes, what we are trying to make it was a real concern. Otherwise, like if you see from the tough thought of consumer IT now moving to the customer, where they are trying to utilize the systems which has created a new horizon, which we find even the small messages, whatever we communicate today, we get the response in a huge way. So the expectation beyond after COVID, surely we feel whatever which is that only way of technology, now it is forced like the technology is the only way and they are trying to use it as much as. So this shows very clearly like if it's a need and demand is already generated, the technology plays a major role and the crisis, the technology is tested for the best. So our internal research, what we feel happy and trying to redesign that applications, whatever is meant for bulk users, now we are able to create it for individual users and trying to create that how they can trying to connect, engage with the customer so that they can create that enough business and trying to empower the collections timely and make it more digitally. So we would take this opportunity, whatever, even though it's a problem, big crisis across the country, but you can say like almost some more than 50% of the customers, they are able to communicate through mobile, which was a big difference in normal days where even rural, they used to have an infrastructure as an excuse. They didn't get connected. Now the advantage is what? Now they are able to connect, they are able to get more systems. Now we have to have a stable and dependable, sustainable system, which we can go back to them for such huge volumes. So the centralized system which supporting the mobile systems, which was for a different volume, now it is increased and it's going to increase more after post-COVID. Surely we are expecting a lot more improvements in infrastructure, trying to create as much as intent so that the customer-based systems should have more trying to consume that consumers and trying to enable the intermediate system broker dealer agents to be more digital so that the technology comes easier and we are able to control with the security models and trying to enable the system which is more digital post-COVID.
Thanks, Suresh. Amit?
So today technology is the backbone for any business and when it comes to captivating the business to the new heights. As a CDO, my job is to show how new technology can address my organization's needs both now and in future. This can develop new business, achieve growth, and at the same time ensure staying ahead of the competition. There are two combinations which I feel can play a major role in the digital journey. One is to improve agility and responsiveness, and of course, the innovation. To remain competitive, we need to be able to respond quickly to the marketplace changes and customer demands. As we all know, coronavirus is now powering the movement towards digital banking, and no bank is exception to it. Banks are anticipating this change and towards digital banking and taking relevant measures by implementing completely digitized and remote customer transactions. Banks can ensure that both everyday and exceptional processes will be carried out seamlessly. But I feel technology over the years has evolved and we have seen massive transformation already. It has already improved working conditions relentlessly. Remember how the banks used to operate way back in 90s, wherein there were no digital channels, there were no RTGS, no NEFT, no ATM cards, no ATMs. Technology has changed everything since last, I think, couple of decades. We have seen huge changes with respect to the work style and the way we used to operate in early 90s and the way we are operating right now. And what I feel is we just notice it when means currently there is a tough time like for a coronavirus, and then we are talking about work from home and everything, but work from home is there since long time. It is just that we are realizing or noticing it right now. About future technology, I will say, of course, this will remain. And I think going ahead, banks will adopt more and more software defined approach, wherein everything will be software defined. Likes of virtual network, virtual storage, virtual platform, with all-in-one software-defined console managed, which is managing everything seamlessly. We will be focusing on user experience, which will hover around next-gen offerings such as fingertip availability, real-time collaboration, real-time demand-supply match, ease of use, self-service. And even after this coronavirus passes, I think, of course, digital solutions will be there and will have an enduring relevance to its customers who are increasingly spending time now. It's actually increased the use of digital platforms. We can see that in our senior citizen segment as well, wherein they have adopted mobile banking and they have started using mobile banking and NEFT transactions, RTGS transaction on their own. So again, we will have to think on that perspective as well, wherein once this corona virus phase passes, will this kind of a generation who has already spended time in adopting digital channels will again get back to the normal orthodox banking and spend time in traveling to reach banks and taking efforts to get the things done which they can do seamlessly on their fingertips. Moreover, point is customer expectations can change completely. Banks need to start from that perspective as well.
Hey, thanks, Amit. Hi, good afternoon. Thanks for inviting me to this session. Pleasure being here and speaking to everyone. So a generation of change is happening in a matter of months, actually. A lot of walls being broken, a lot of fixed notions that people had about IT networks, the way IT development had to be done in banking has changed dramatically. Banks were used to traditional waterfall models. All of them are into agile mode now. I heard other panelists speak about developments which used to take a month being rolled out in 24 hours or a week's time. So that's the new normal. And also this entire fixed notion about offices, desktops, fancy cabins, everything is getting destroyed. It's more about collaboration, remote working spaces. The notions of hierarchy will also slowly move away. It is more about skill sets, capability, delivery. These are the new normals. So there is obviously a lot of adoption of digital happening. But apart from that, how this entire digital change is being enabled, the back end, the support systems, the organization structures, that is also changing quite dramatically. And the entire bureaucracy that used to exist in banking and in the technology world in banking is getting changed for the better. So that's one good news. So you have a lot of flexibility, you have a lot of openness with respect to adoption of new technology. VPNs, which were a no-no in NBFC and banking space, is suddenly the new normal, and you put in security systems to enable all these things. So that's about banking. So I'm representing a startup called Savvy, where I am the chief operating officer. We are essentially a neobank aspirant. But thanks to this pandemic, we have had to accelerate our plans, and we will be launching the savings phase initially, because it resonated well in this current times where everyone is keen to save for various set of goals, children's education, small marriages, organize their savings bit, get visibility on how their investments are. And all this is being fueled or supported by the entire digital revolution, whether it is the KYC part, the handheld devices, the cloud infrastructure to support the entire platform. Even our developers operate from different, so the UI UX team works from Mumbai, the development team is in Chandigarh. So which otherwise would have been a mental block. We would have wanted everyone to converge in one single office and work in one single location. But now, thanks to this entire paradigm shift, we are able to, there's more use of project management tools like Trello, Jira boards, etc. The conventional IT minds never could get their heads around a project management board or anything like that. Now that's the new normals. There are other behavioral aspects also that this has brought in. Everybody has to develop new social skills because hierarchy is no longer so relevant. You have to be more collaborative. You need to have flexible policies. You need to continuously upskill so that you are ahead of the curve, or you can become redundant. Domain skills are suddenly become quite relevant rather than being generalist. Humility is the new order of the day. So everybody's arrogance has kind of tempered down. So all these are other behavioral aspects also. That's kind of the gig economy is suddenly getting recognized. Everybody is talking about migrant laborers, their troubles. Otherwise, they were a hidden face in the crowd and you would never talk about them. So these are new things apart from technology that's emerging. And thanks to it, we have kind of learned to work in a more flexible manner, collaborate better. We recognize each other's compulsions better. We adopt technology faster. And we are able to share best practices also. Now, best practices are being shared more openly. What works for one organization, they are happy to share and help the other organization also implement. So these are good things. Yeah, but it's tough times, and we hope all of us stay safe and we come out of it stronger and more successful than before.
Thanks, sir. Mohit, over to you.
So I just would present a different view in terms of how a technology company is looking at, say, banking segment to start with. And then we'll talk about the current scenario of this pandemic and the crisis. So if you look at, BFSI, segment, or some people call it as financial services sector, I believe this sector has been in the forefront of technology exploitation much ahead of any other sector or a segment, and it is that technology has become a differentiator in this sector, and people say your product is as good as your technology. So what you can offer to your customers because of the IT that you have, the enablement that you can do for your customers, your employees, is going to differentiate you. And as I said, this sector has been in forefront of technology deployment since I've been in the industry for the last 22 odd years, and I've been working with large and small banks across the country. I've seen that technology has been always the boardroom discussion when it comes to banking and finance, because that's how you come out with new type of offerings for your customers. And this alternate channel thing, which started long time back, and then online banking, so many different innovations happening. How to enable banking in most modern fashion for your customers. It has been the theme for a long time. And I would say, banks are actually like IT companies. One of the leaders from one of the largest banks in the world said, we're actually an IT company in the business of banking. So that is so true about this particular segment. And we look at it as VMware, what we look at it is, we are in the business of providing the digital foundation to our customers. And banking and finance sector is one of the biggest sectors for us because a lot of activities happen around technology innovations in this sector. Now, we started some, again, 22 years back with the basic product for virtualization, and that's been the foundation, or that's been something for which we have been known for as a leader in the industry. But a lot of innovation has happened around that product, and a lot of innovation has happened in terms of the portfolio that we offer today. We believe that our customers, when they talk about digital transformation, they're talking about applications, the new type of applications that they want to roll out, whether it is for the employee experience or it is for the customer experience or for their corporate requirements. And these applications nowadays are of different types, and you want to build applications using, say, containers, Kubernetes, or microservices, or you want to continue with your legacy applications, monolithic applications, three-tier applications. So we understand that application is the forefront of your digital transformation. What we can enable as an organization for our customers is, how do we help you build these applications? How do we help you run these applications? How do we help you manage these applications? And finally, how do we connect and protect all these applications? So this is the theme or the portfolio that we offer to our customers. And that's what we refer as the foundation for digital transformation. In this era of work from home, and I heard all of you speak about it, so I don't want to repeat those things, but the thing is that a lot of things which were already existing and we were offering to our customers for a very long time actually became more relevant. So the idea was how we could help the customers expand their ability to work from home. And work from home, while it sounds like cliche, but the fact is that it's not just about allowing people to use a VPN and access an application, but I think it's much more beyond that when it comes to an enterprise which is worried about security. How do we allow our employees to access our enterprise applications using any device? Basically, he is going to use his own device. It could be a laptop, iPad, a tablet, or a desktop at home. And then he is going to access some business critical applications, which are your own enterprise applications having confidential data, which of course in your industry is prime importance because you are highly regulated. So our job or our portfolio, we offer something called digital workspace or workspace one as a solution, which enables access of these digital applications, enterprise applications, through a secure launcher, secure tunnel. And not just access, but how you manage the access of these applications in terms of ensuring that there are no loopholes in terms of security. How do you manage the endpoint completely? How do you actually manage the notice the end user behavior? The second thing is, how do we expand these applications, whether on-prem or on cloud? And all of you are experts in this, and you spoke about it. Cloud is nothing new today, but what is new is that the consumption of cloud is going to increase much faster than it was anticipated earlier. And the reason being, people are not willing to be dependent on the delivery of hardware now. People have challenges in terms of accessing their data centers and the ability to expand on the own infrastructure versus a hyperscaler's infrastructure is very different. So what we are offering to our customers, and successfully partnered with a lot of customers during these crises also, is to give them ability to expand into public cloud without making changes to their applications. Because the main challenge which some of you would have faced is, it's easy to talk about a public cloud, but the challenge comes when you have to move an application from on-prem to a cloud, and how you need to refactor it, redesign it so that it can run in a public cloud environment. What we offer as VMware is an ability which is called multi-cloud, wherein whatever you're running on-prem on your virtual estate, you can just copy and paste it into a hyperscaler, whether it is, say, AWS or for that matter any hyperscaler like Google, Azure, IBM, or Ali for that matter, and even Oracle. So you can do this kind of load, shift. You can, shift the applications from one data center that is your on-prem to cloud without really being worried about migration. While even do modernization, obviously, even after migration. So we say it's not that you need to modernize first and then migrate. You can migrate first and then modernize, and you can take your consistent operations which you are running today on-prem, and as it is, it goes along with the security policies, all your access and everything what you have defined on-prem, it goes onto the cloud. So nutshell, if you look at how we have been partnering with our customers in all segments, specifically in banking and finances, helping them really harness the technology in terms of enabling their employees access enterprise applications from using any device. We have helped the customers in terms of running any applications, whichever applications they have, on any type of cloud, whether it is on-prem cloud or it is a hyperscaler or whatever kind of cloud it is. And the idea is that the business should go on. It should not matter how and where the things are running, where the workloads are running.
Hey, thanks, Mohit. So we'll do just one question each, and then subsequently, I think some of the audience questions we'll see if we can pick it up. Otherwise, we will answer it to those. So Puneet, with your permission, I'll just start with ABK sir, with Mr. Balakrishnan, and then I'll come over to you. So I interrupted you when you were mentioning the last point on the technology roadmap. So so that point, if you could emphasize again, sir, what is Geojit doing on the technology roadmap?
Right. So as I mentioned, actually, we were building fixed assets in technology, which we are now internally contemplating whether we should do like this. So probably we accelerate our cloud movement even for our core application. There are regulatory challenges which we are contemplating, because now regulators also understood that there are a lot many things to be changed in terms of the security framework and also the methodology in which we execute the transactions, managing the customers, customer assets, etc. Last 5-6 weeks, if you look into the maximum number of circulars on changes actually came, the frequency of the circular actually very, very high in terms of the possibility of making changes in the procedures and the methodology, etc. This I am talking about the SEBI and its reporting, the terminal deployment, even transaction management, etc. At the same time, there is a security challenge. Actually, when we talk about VPN, when we talk about the work from home, and we are actually extending a lot of information to home, which includes the portfolio of the customers, etc. Even though there are certain kind of rules and regulation, it is a challenging time in terms of security and its standards. We may have to redefine it. We may have to find other means of protecting the customers' data, including their investments and etc. However, but what is actually which is crystal clear now, that building our own assets without elasticity, it will be a killer in the long term. So that is how we are. And another thing which we are actually a major learning is e-collaboration, e-meeting, and how to manage work from home. As I mentioned, the self-motivation of employees is very important to get a good productivity. So on those grounds, actually, we are actually working.
Yeah, thanks. Thanks a lot, sir. A quick question to you, Puneet. I think, very interesting point you raised about this changing role of the CIO. How, the CIO is not just a chief information officer anymore. There is a lot more part he or she plays in the strategy of the firm, especially in financial services firm. If you could just elaborate on that aspect.
So what I feel is that the chief information officers has become the chief investigation officers, basically. you know, basically the people who are your peers, basically they have a lot of expectation from IT. So it is, you know, a learning phase for not only for IT to understand the business, equally it is an opportunity for business to learn IT, basically. So how, unless this collaboration would not work, the deliverables is not going to happen. So earlier we, you take up any project, like, you know, even smaller big time change requests and all, there is a formality of that BRD, then all that stuff and all that stuff, like, you know, and understanding the business, what exactly is the current state and what like is the new change management which is going to take place. What is the business impact analysis? There is a major change going forward. So the analysis have totally changed. So in fact, I can say that, you know, the scrums, what we're talking, we used to so-called the scrum calls and all that stuff. So it is more of a team scrum calls now to understand that what is an overall perspective, what is the requirement has come, what is the real need of the hour, what exactly are they expecting. If there are 10 odd requirements which has come, what is the business case as of now, which is you tell us what is your prioritization. And we start working on that. So that is the, and the collaboration happens that where, you know, the one IT person sits along with the business stakeholder who is the process owner, they'll collaborate and deliver a product. That's what they said, as early as 24 hours to 48 hours. That collaboration thing which was missing is totally turned the mindset of people that, like, you know, IT is just not about facilitation. It's something where equal focus, you know, in fact, at Manapuram, we've got a lot of mandates where it's being enforced by our management that, you know, immediately every person in other business verticals have to learn one course in IT. So we do a lot of trainings, upskill that said. So suddenly people have been told to be, you know, start working on Tableau implementation on their own as an admin. So for a lot of, you know, technology related emphasis has come where people who are from MCOM background, they are pulled into data services. They have been told to learn Python to do RPAs. It's like that. So it's a mixed kind of a culture, what we are saying here. It is just about the convenience to either for ourselves or to extend to the internal stakeholder and overall the, you know, 360 degree approach of the business getting changed overnight. That is one thing. Apart from that, I see that there is a lot more scope where, you know, a lot of manual intervention was there. And, you know, in case of, like, you know, where we can, technology can play a very big role through these new emerging technologies, co-creation models and all that stuff is really reaping its benefit. Third station, what I feel is that, like, you know, the investigation, what I ensure the investigation is that I see that let's have over a cup of tea, though no more, because we have to maintain social distancing. So at least come on a Teams call, ask the teams to do more of a IT and, you know, HR engagements, do IT and, you know, internal engagements to understand where they are facing pain areas, if IT can help them out to, you know, ease out that operations. So investigation is in terms of the business process automation, what I feel. So that is something which I say that we, the new norm is the chief investigation officer.
Thanks, very interesting, chief investigation. So while we get Dr. Ravindran onto the screen, Suresh, if I can ask you, so you're, you know, you're the researcher in this group and somebody who would probably see and think of technology before, you know, some of the other users see. What do you think are some of the big ideas on, you know, from technology which is going to get adopted in banks and NBFCs?
Only in crisis, IT moves up in the ladder and several endless reasons technology is powerful when it is put on test. So we should take positive as of whatever is happening. You can hear from all the people that transformation happens during crisis very easily and technology takes advantage of that. So let us try to get things said right from the post-COVID-19. Future logically bring out more business, which we use a term called customer IT. Earlier we had something called corporate IT, business IT, now move to customer IT, which is nothing but to establish deeply, ensure all the basics right and installed in their favor of customer, trying to enable similar ways of having an understanding about customer and trying to enable what else we can do in terms of engagement with the customer. What we are saying in other words is what customer IT, part of research, gives a revised IT, considering and conceiving self-control, correction, discipline, which is nothing but everybody wants IT. You take business, you take whichever ways of means of concern, people now own IT. And I can see the request in last, whatever you say, 2 months, 3 months, almost 60% of the people have asked for VPN. In good olden days, without an IT person visiting their homes, none of the VPNs work. today even people doesn't visit on their own, they are able to implement using the remote locations, remote connections, they are able to do it. So let us see something called customer IT, which is nothing but people owns IT, and people have to, means this is a qualification now. Until they don't own IT, they can't get connected, they won't get those salaries, they won't get their what are best for the benefits of that. So we call something called belief, belief behavior, binary business benefit.
Oh, thanks a lot. Very interesting. Dr. Ravindran, now you're already using a lot of interesting things, including Salesforce, etc. Do you see this reaching out to customers completely changing for Shakti Finance in the future?
No, like what Shanmugam indicated, no. Like we are not in a position to underestimate our customers at all. And I also touched upon in my earlier points, the tax savviness, etc. and all, no, it's all gone actually. And again, no, the customers, new millennials, no, millennials are coming up or no, they are supporting actually. So using of smartphones has become a very common thing actually. So even the expectation of the customers and also the expectation of the management, no, like try to reach as maximum as possible, no, the customers to deliver what they need. And whatever technology or platform or app you want to use, no, I think it's your liberty, no, to use it. So that's become now very standard. That's a critical requirement. And again, after COVID-19, no, that's become still, no, it's become a mandatory part. So using this software, even we ought to develop a portal specifically for customers, for them, no, to raise their queries. And they get the results immediately. Even we are planning to use WhatsApp for that. And you know, this Salesforce is going to really help us, you know, to even, you know, move the monitor the movements of our marketing force.
Thanks a lot. Mohit, if you can quickly, some piece of advice for the CIO, what should he or she be focusing on in the future?
So a couple of things. I think CIOs definitely know these things better than anybody else can tell them. I think the focus has been and it continues to be on how, like Puneet ma'am just mentioned, that how your role is changing today in terms of helping the business do wonders with the customer experience and the employee experience. So I think what CIOs would have to continue to focus is the ability to roll out new workloads, new applications. Okay. So business would continue to come at the last moment saying that this is the top priority and you would not have enough time to provision hardware or IT, but I want this up and running as of yesterday. So time, you know, will always be a challenge. And preparing ourselves to deliver to the business at a very unforeseen speed is going to continue to be something they would continue to focus. And most important thing that CIOs would not have liberty to overlook is the security aspect of anything that they do, because security is prime and it has to be at the center of whatever they do, because ultimately it's the name of the organization which is at stake, it's the business of the organization that's at stake. So whatever good you do, if it is not done with proper security measures, proper security architecture, it may lead to biggest disasters. So I think security and agility would be the two things that would continue to be the focus of CIOs going forward as well.
Thanks a lot, Mohit. Gunjan, so in the, because of time and even some of the panelists who are here want to leave as well, we will close the session now. I offer to pick up any of the questions which come in later. Do send me the questions and I will have the respective panelists answer, and we will coordinate it that way.